children.
Good morning.
Sit down. So last time we gave you a homework, right? We had discussed first battle of Panipat, and I asked you to find out that what exactly happened in the second and the third battle of Panipat. Who is going to tell me? Sanskriti, second battle of Panipat.
I think battle of Panipat was between Akbar and Afghan rulers.
Okay, what was the outcome?
The outcome was
Hemu, the rival king,
lost to Akbar won.
Okay, Akbar won the second battle of Panipat. Sit up, Sanskriti. Anjali, what more you can add?
The second battle of Panipat was fought between the forces of Sangat, Hemchandra, Vikramaditya, who was also known as Hemu, and he was the Hindu king, and the army of Akbar. The major reason was that 1 month before the second battle of Panipat, Hemu had conquered Delhi by defeating the Mughals at the Battle of Delhi. To reclaim the city, Mughals declared a war. This Battle of Panipat was fought on November 5th, 1556.
All right. You committed a mistake, Sanskrit. Did you identify your mistake? Hemu was not a Khan leader, he was a Hindu king. Okay? Sit down. Okay, so second battle of Panipat was fought between Hemu and Akbar. Akbar was victorious, and that was the beginning of the golden era of Mughal Empire. Then we basically talk about the Mughals, who we largely talk about Akbar, because he consolidated, he strengthened the empire. And the decline of Mughal Empire, when did it start? With
Aurangzeb.
Very good. Now who will tell me about third battle of Panipat? Utkarsh.
This battle happened on 14 January 1761.
Okay.
Between Ehmed Shah of Afghanistan and Bajirao Maratha dynasty. Due to rapid territorial gain of the Maratha Empire, the Marathas came across the Afghans and had this battle. The aftermath of this battle was the Maratha loss.
Oh, right. Okay, so the third battle was between Ahmed Shah and Marathas, in which the Marathas lost. Alright, and that was the decline of Maratha Empire. Alright, let's concentrate on Mughals right now. So today we will start making the timeline. Okay, timeline means which major rulers came to the throne, what were essential basic wars, battles, events or incidents during their reign. Alright, we have till now basically done only Babur. So we will only begin with Babur, but in your copy, you will allot one page. Okay, for example, this is your copy, right? So this is the timeline page. You will allot this one page to making of the timeline, or you can also make it on a small chart, 1/4 chart, and you can put it on the board in your room later on, so that while going and coming you can read it and it will be imprinted here. Alright. So coming to the timeline, we will just start with Babur. This is the timeline. Have a one line which denotes the time, passage of time. So we will start with which year?
1526.
Okay. What is the heading we can give here? Only Mughal. Arrival of Babur. Arrival of Babur
dynasty.
Battle of Panipat. Okay. Now after this, battle is Battle of Hanoa. Fine. You can hear like this, highlight the period of power, right? And that way we will keep working as and when we keep discussing the events. Yes. Both are correct. B-A-B-A-R is also correct. B-A-B-U-R is also correct. Why? You have an explanation in English. What kind of noun is power?
Proper noun.
And proper noun, the spellings may change. The names. Okay, suppose my name is Nalini. So whether I write N-A-L-I-N-I or I write N-A-L-I-N-E-E, the pronunciation is same. Choice is hers, but the spellings vary in the historical records. Alright, now coming to a very important part of the Mughal succession, they had a different kind of succession. First of all, tell me if you understand the meaning of succession. Sanskriti, you know the meaning? Come on, tell me. Going, moving onwards in the family tree. Okay? Suppose Babur was the king. Who was the next king?
Humayun.
Who was next?
Babur.
Who was next?
Jahangir.
Next?
Shahjahan.
And next?
Aurangzeb.
Beyond that, we don't need right now. Alright? Usually, what is a sign of monarchy? Can you tell me what is monarchy? Father to the son. What if the father has five sons?
Eldest son.
Right? This is one system of succession, that from father to eldest child. But, sit down. Good, Zoya. But in Mughals, you know, they had a different kind of system. Yes, one would be the in charge, one would be the main king. Yes, Kushal? Yes.
If two sons are of the same age, then twins. Yes.
Then it is the decision of the king. The father. Yes, who is better? Right? Here they had a system that apart from the one who will rule as center, Delhi, rest of the sons would be given lot of property. They would be made like governors. Who are governors? They are in charge of
states.
Right? In those days, present states were not there. But there were different states. Territories. Right? So they were, the area under control was distributed equally in the altar. Now both have their pros and cons. Have you read about this, the one brother of Aurangzeb who was killed by Aurangzeb to get power? Or do you know whether Aurangzeb was the eldest son or the youngest son or what? You don't know. Aurangzeb was not the eldest son. Okay? He killed Dara Shikoh, the eldest and the favorite son of Shah Jahan, to gain access to the throne. Now, in the Mughal system of succession, this was always a possibility. The other children may not be happy with the area they were granted. And that is why they always pose a challenge for the ruler at Delhi, for the child or for the man who was ruling at the center. This was one problem they faced continuously, but that is something different. The main basis of success of Mughals is their administrative system. This we will continue as we go, right? So this page has to be left in your copy. As we will face important incidents, we will keep them. Now, what do you mean by administrative system? Administration. Yes, Anjali.
Administrative system was a system in which it was decided how the country or the city will be governed and how will it be kept, the districts and the states.
Excellent. Anybody explain with the taking a very general example? Take the administration of school. What is the system of administration in the school? Who is at the top?
CEO.
Then we have the principal. Then we have the vice principal. Then we have the coordinators. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Right? And then we have the class teachers. And if class teacher is not in the class, who takes the responsibility? Class representatives. Right? This is what is meant by administrative system. How to control and manage a particular field and area. In our case, the school, right? They were excellent with their administrative system and they introduced two kinds of system. First is called Mansabdari. That finally led to what is the system of landlords called? Which was there in the British era. After independence, that system was abolished, the titles were taken away. In the villages, what is the system? No, that is after independence. Before independence, what was the system?
Caste
system is a social system. Political system, you tell me. Who was at the peak? Who used to manage the administration of the village?
Chieftains,
what is the other name? A Hindi word for that?
Panchayat
is post independence. Can you tell me now? With Z?
Zamindari.
Excellent. Zamindari system. This Mansabdari system finally gave way to Zamindari system. The chieftain, as you said, or the zamindar was the in charge. Right. Now, what exactly is Mansabdari system? If you have a guess, you know that it is a system of administration of the country. That means the area under the Mughal Empire. Can you try? Yes, Papi.
Yes, so that is the people from other kingdoms.
The kingdom joined. See, we last time we discussed that Mughals had a friendly relation, had developed a lot of diplomatic relation, whether by war or by marriage with Rajputs. They had major battle with Punjab and Ahoms, the residents of Assam. Right? Now, whatever area is there under Mughals, how are they going to manage? What is first thing they will have to take care of? The ruler is at Delhi. Ruler is sitting at Delhi. And they have their empire till Deccan in the south, till Bengal,
protection.
Rajasthan, protection of boundary. Okay. What else? Yes, Anjali.
They have to take care of all the greenery they have and they have to build magnets to protect them from the neighboring empires.
That is again protection. Utkarsh.
Revolutions.
To manage, tackle the rebels, the rebellions. Okay, what else? Imagine there is no system of administration in the school.
Tax.
No, there is taxation. Very good. One important point. Yes, Bhakti. The loyalty. What else? Suppose there is no police. Suppose there is no defense.
Law.
Law and order. Right? What is the requirement? Law and order. Then, as Siddharth said, taxation, safety, right? Law and order will be done through at time of Mughals. We are not talking of present time. At that time. So the soldiers had to manage and the cases will be brought to the attention of the head, whosoever, suppose in Delhi, then of course to the notice of the king. And what will happen in other districts where king is not available?
Governor.
Okay, some areas, you remember the system of Ikta? Who may tell me what was system of Ikta? Understand the system of Ikta, then you know what is Mansabdar. Yes.
Iktas were lands temporarily given to soldiers who were known as Muftis. They had to take care of the Iktas, ensure law and order, and see whether the merchants are giving the things at a reasonable price.
Excellent. Yes,
Papa.
Ikta of those times now came to be known as Mansab. The area under and in charge. Okay. Suppose the class representatives of 70 are the in charges of 70. They cannot meddle in the administration of 70, 7A, 7C. Right? So your control is over your area. You cannot meddle. So as I told you, they had a big empire. And so what they did, they divided land into mansabs. You can compare it to present time districts. You know every state is divided into districts, right? So you can compare them to districts. And then one in charge of mansab was known as mansabdar. Alright, now there is one difference between mansabdari system, mansab and ikta, which you may not be knowing. Where did the Muftis live? Suppose this is one Ikta and there is one Mukti. Okay, Siddharth, stand up. You are the Mukti of this Ikta. You are the in charge. How will you manage the administration? Where will you live?
I need to send
in your area. Correct? In your area. Suppose this is one Ikta and another Ikta is 7C and another Ikta is 7B. Will you go and live in 7B and C?
In
7D. Right? That was the system during Iktidari. Sit up. In Mansabdari, what was different is that Mansabdar did not necessarily live in Mansab. Because usually those Mansabdars were the governors, they might be away from their Mansabs or their districts. Often visiting Delhi, often visiting the center, and then managing, appointing their deputies, their subordinates to manage the administration. Have you understood? Now, for Mansabdari, for managing the duties of being a Mansab, duties of managing a Mansab, what will I need? Suppose I am a Mansabdar. Okay, to manage law and order, collect revenue, manage administration, keeping in mind the Mughal era, what will I need? Wait, Anjali, let others tell. Exercise your brains. Will I, okay, there is a crime I am running there. There is a revenue to be collected. Soldiers. Very good. Soldiers. That means a small army. So, all the Mansabdars were also used for military services. They were allowed to keep small armies for continuation of their duties as who said that for maintaining the borders, the boundaries, right? There was always a threat that a neighboring king will want my land. So, maintaining the law and order inside the Mansab, protecting my Mansab from intrusion, law and order, revenue collection, I needed an army. So a military service was also part of Mansabdari system. Now your homework. Fine, I write it. Note it down. In this vacation, you will Google or search on two topics. Search and research. Alright? Search and research. One is 9 gems of Akbar's court. I will not explain, you all know. Nauratan. You all have heard. Right? Akbar ke darbar ke Nauratan. The 9 gems. Don't tell me right now, this is homework. And Deen e Ilahi. So next time when we meet after the vacation, I will be asking you about the 9 gems and delay. Okay? Thank you, children.